Well, hey everybody, this is Marty Mongello, and I'm super psyched for today to be triggering another wonderful episode of Crypto Genius. And of course, it's not all about crypto. We love blockchain here. We have some wonderful guests. We also love AI, anything groovy. Of course, crypto is always on our mind. Wallets, hard wallets, soft wallets. Don't forget, we love everything to do with HoloLens VR. So we may have to change the name of this show someday to high tech. But without further ado, let's get started for the day. And thank you for joining us. Well, thank you again for another chance to host a fantastic show from the Presidential Center here in the United States of America. I'm in the second largest banking capital of America, New York being the number one. I'm in Charlotte, North Carolina, and I'll throw it over to our host, Farah. Do you want to tell people where you are on the other side of the world?
Yes, thank you, Marty, so much for hosting this event. I'm all the way from Kuala Lumpur, and now it's already Eid. Eid Mubarak to all viewers who are Muslim and celebrating. This is the inaugural show of the Crypto Genius that is hosted by the USPSC, and we welcome all to join us in discovering the trajectory of the growth of cryptocurrency, NFTs, and all things tech.
Well, thank you so much, Farah, and happy Eid starting today. Hajj has ended, and also on Saturday we had Lesotho's the king's birthday on Saturday, and I believe Serbia Independence Day was Saturday also. They were celebrating Independence Day this weekend. So, Istiak, would you like to say hello today?
Hey everyone, I am joining in all the way from Bangladesh. I am very new to the whole cryptocurrency scene. I am, unfortunately, you know, cryptocurrencies are banned in my country right now. So I'm just learning as much as possible about it so I could at least be part of the dialogue. Hopefully one day it'll become easily accessible here as well. And till then, you know, we'll keep the dialogue going. Thank you very much for having me.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Siak. And we also have Marques Hardin, Jeremy Schultz. Jeremy, did I say that correctly? Schultz?
You say that correctly. Yes, okay. Schultz.
The Canadians over here, Jeremy, they say, we can tell where you learned French. You must have lived in Europe. I'm like, I did. I lived in Europe for like 3 years. I have like the Parisian accent, evidently.
Oh. So
sometimes I get made fun of.
You don't have the most easiest accent. Yeah, as a Parisian accent.
It is. And you guys have 26 letters in your alphabet, just like English. So it's like,
yeah.
It's really, really, I think, the easiest language. And a lot of words are exactly the same, right, Marques? Restaurant is restaurant. So. Marques Hardin, Marques, did you want to say hello from Paris?
No, I was going to say, like, for people that want to know, there are 10,000 similar words between the languages, between English and French. So it's not a distant language to learn for people who are interested.
Interesting.
Amazing to see. And today we have the good fortune of Jeremy and Marques. are going to show us all about NFTs for today's show, and specifically NFT museums. This is mind-blowing, guys, NFT museums. Marques and Jeremy, do you guys want to take it away?
Yeah, so let me explain. So Art Jones is a tech and art business that Jeremy and I run together. And when NFTs came out, Jeremy pinged my phone. He said, "Marques, did you just see the $69 million sale of an NFT with Christie's?" And I said, "Yes, I saw the article. I can't believe it. What's happening?" And Jeremy said, "Okay, we need to figure out something here." And I said, "Well, of course. I mean, in 2008, I was living in Los Angeles, and I did a tour with my artist friend Robert Morgan. And we visited some artists in the digital section of the brewery. And they said, well, digital artists aren't getting the respect that they deserve at this present moment. So fast forward into 2001. And a digital art piece sells for $69 million by Christie's, one of the largest auction houses in the world. So Jeremy is like pulling my hair and tugging at my shoulders and pulling my ears, like, come this way to the NFTs. And I said, okay, Jeremy, all right, brother, but we're not going to be a marketplace. So what are we going to do? And Jeremy, like, we had like a really cool discussion about this. And then I said, you know what, why don't we just focus on displaying it? And then we have Art Jones 3D, which is a virtual gallery design company. And we've been working on different types of virtual spaces, et cetera, et cetera. And then I said, Jeremy, okay, let me introduce you to the team and let's get started on this virtual gallery. And this is how we entered the NFT market.
Mm-hmm. And we have to thanks to our team that create a very unique gallery and unique museum. They really give their maximum potential of creating a full immersive and full interactive gallery that it never have been created before on internet. So we really create a new kind of way to visit an exhibition and to be immersed and to feel it. Because, you know, digital artwork is still digital, but it's still also art. So the value of art is also how the emotion can give it to you. And with digital, you have to bring it to another dimension, and we really did that humbly with our exhibition.
Well, fantastic, c'est fantastique. We also have the good fortune of Naquib has joined us now. Naquib, how are you doing today?
I'm fine, thank you so much. Apologies for the delay, critical technological issues coming up.
We're all dealing with it. Naquib, we're talking about NFTs. Of course, I know you know already, and NFT museums today. And Jeremy and Marques have been just mentioning how they got started. Marques, what's that painting? Is that painting from Iran you were talking about behind you?
Mustafa Serebi. He's an Iranian artist out of Tehran specifically. And I acquired this piece about 2 years ago, I believe, and he I love this artist because in a way he's kind of deranged in the sense that he does paint these images of his family, typically of his family, but in this sense he's painting I think of his probably his brother or something like that, and of course of this mystical I think horses are just magical creatures of this horse in the forest. So it's about 150 by 100 centimeters, and it's one of my prized possessions.
Wow, it looks so cool. And Jeremy, what do you have behind you today?
Here, as you can see, it's a
donut. So
before my head. So before being in NFTs, I was managing a street artist for 5 years, and one of these artists called Gizbar, was one of the first artists that I managed. And he's more pop street artist, which means that he's a studio artist, but he's also influenced by urban art. So as you can see, he's a very juicy donut that you can have in the US. And you have the numbers of calories and calories in Chinese.
Wow.
So, yeah, so that's pretty much like the a good
it's reference a one on the one
of the time. Culinary culture in US. And he twisted with a very pop vision. So yeah.
Well, one of my favorite things to do is on the Seine River, to go down there and visit the artists by the Seine out there painting. And I have a lot of their paintings and purchase and support them, and then have had them framed, and we have them here in on display. So
I totally agree with you. Actually, recently I direct a street art festival in Paris called the Color Festival. And during 6 weeks, we welcomed 25,000 visitors in Paris.
Wow.
Yeah, and that was really amazing and very wonderful experience. And we worked with a real estate development company that lent us a building. So we had the opportunity to use two floors, fully repainted by a street artist. So it was, 600 square meters. So I'm sorry, I don't know how much is in square inch. But that was a lot of painting, like 55 artists in total, half men, half women. And we had also a parity of known and unknown artists to allow them to fully be recognized by the people without their previous notoriety. So that was a really, really wonderful experience.
Amazing. Well, I know Farah's got some questions today. So Farah, it is almost 12 minutes into the show. Yep, it's 12 minutes. So we'd like to kick it over to Farah for today's questions.
Yeah, I have a few questions for all of you, especially for Marques, Jeremy, Nakib, and all of you. Okay, we start with Marques and Jeremy. If I have some artist friend here in Malaysia or around this region, Indonesia especially, are they able to also participate in the current initiative that you're doing? That's one. And then for those who are into cryptocurrencies, what are the strategies for cryptocurrencies that you would propose to all of the listeners out there? And also, later on, I would like to invite my friend, Nakib. He is the founder of Marhaba Token, Islamic DeFi. So we would love to hear from Nakib after this. Thank you.
So I'll let Jeremy answer the artist part. And then I'll focus on the cryptocurrency. Cryptocurrency. Oh, you want to go first?
I don't. You say I let Jeremy talk about art, so I thought you were allowed me to speak first.
Double play.
Oh, okay. Well, go ahead, Jeremy. Go ahead, Jeremy.
Vas-y.
It is actually money, right? L'argent.
Sorry.
Argent.
L'argent in French, it is money in me. No,
it's a play on. It's definitely a play on words. Argent is money.
Is money in French? Yeah.
But it's money in French. But it was like art is spelled A-R-G-E-N-T versus A-R-T. You know, G-N-E in a C-E. Yeah. So it was a play on words. It was a play on words.
Okay. Go ahead. Yes.
So quickly on cryptocurrency. What's important that people need to know about cryptocurrency is that it's highly volatile. And a highly volatile market means that you can lose a lot of money very quickly as well as gain a lot of money very quickly. But it's not very different from trading, you know, currency in a multi-trillion dollar currency market or trading stocks. You still have to be conscious of price action if you're trading short term, and then if you're trading for the long term, you need to make sure that you enter into cryptocurrency at the right price, depending on, you know, where you are in the market. But of course, you know, dollar cost averaging is, you know, the long-term strategy, because Jeremy and I believe wholeheartedly that cryptocurrency is going to be around for a very long time. It's being adopted by a lot of multi-billion dollar companies as a way of purchasing goods. But I don't want people to think that getting into cryptocurrency is a get rich, you know, quick kind of thing. I mean, you still have to be very wise in how you invest your money. You can easily put $500 or 500 euro into cryptocurrency and lose it, half of it in a day. So what are you going to do? Are you going to panic? So you need to be very, very conscientious of that. Now, with that being said, growth-wise, I do believe in the next 10 years, it's going to be one of the fastest growing markets, you know, in the world, because it's still very brand new. I mean, it's still very brand new. It's still working on its credibility. But I think it's important for people to understand that when you invest in a cryptocurrency, you need to understand their business model. If you understand their business model, then you know that, okay, I'm with this company for the long term because their business model is for whatever it is, okay? So I think that's important that you study each of the cryptocurrencies that you plan to invest in. And with that, I turn it over to Jeremy.
Thank you, Marques.
You're welcome. Yeah, so the benefit of cryptocurrencies went to NFTs. For the people that watch our conferences and who doesn't know what is an NFT, basically an NFT is a cryptocurrency that cannot be properly exchanged in a way that one NFT and another one have not the same value, which means that when you create an NFT, it's pretty much unique. So that technology have been created around 2017. And recently, around last November, so November 2020, artists felt that they could use that NFT as a way to protect and to trace their original creation. So according to that, the market just exploded and bloomed, literally. As Marques said earlier, artists like Beeples sold 29 millions artwork. Millions dollar artwork, so something that it's really close to what you can sell in modern art compared to Basquiat's or a piece of Picasso basically can be 29 millions. So it gave a real credit to digital artists and give them the credibility and the efficiency to be part of that market. So according to that, I want to give an homage to those artists that start as a regular digital artist and become a real artist in the art market. So for our show, we invited 11 artists from all around the world.
Okay.
Unfortunately, not from Malaysia or Indonesia, but soon.
Yeah, sorry about that. Next time. Hey, Jeremy, can I touch on something?
A lot of artwork here. It's really, you know, the design for the region, you know, is really concentrated. It's really nice.
Yeah, I'm sure. I've been in Jakarta 2 years back, and I visited some art gallery, and I was really impressed with the traditional artwork. So I'm sure amazing, you know, stuff. Everything can be adapted to digital way. So I will not be surprised that very talented Indonesian or even Malaysian artists can pop or are already known or should be known for sure. So we allow those artists to give with our gallery a real dimension for their artwork. So it's really an homage. This exhibition is an homage to those artists that should be recognized as real artists, but NFT give them that possibility. So we really wanted to point it for sure. So responding to answer to your question, sorry, Farah. Of course, we can invite some of you artists, and I would be very happy to see their work and to involve them in our exhibition and future exhibition for sure.
Thank you so much.
Can I add one thing to what Jeremy said? So, sure. Authentication. I mean, it's really all about authentication. I mean, that is the reason why the you know, you can now use the blockchain to authenticate artwork. And it was, in this particular case, you know, digital art gifts, visual art with the videos, you're using NFT to authenticate the artwork. So there have been many times in the art world, and actually I'm experiencing this now, where artwork is sent all over the world. There's my artist that I'm working with, David Twas. He has artwork in Russia and Bangladesh and somewhere else. Well, how do you keep track of it? How do you keep track of where the artwork is going, what museum is in, besides, you know, having, you know, someone telling you like, okay, it's now here, it's now there. Well, if you register the artwork, then you can keep track of it in the blockchain. And so then you're not asking like, where's this piece of art or whatnot. So I'm encouraging all artists out there to get familiar with the blockchain to authenticate your work, besides, you know, writing on the back of the artist, which is a, you know, old tradition of authenticating the work. So, but yeah, everybody should be a part of the blockchain. And the NFTs in the future will be applied to other things besides digital art. And so, you know, it'll be applied to, you know, maybe vintage cars or, you know, something like that. We never know, but it's definitely a growing field.
It's already used for many, many domains. Like you can buy collectibles. So not only artwork, you can buy extract of NBA shoots. You can buy your event ticket on NFTs. Mm-hmm. You have many, many applied for that technology. It's a very, very interesting technology that we will hear about it for a while. And I'm sure that many, many of our current used will be replaced by NFTs, such as contract signing. I mean everything that can be used with technology will be used by NFTs, by that tracing and that authentication.
Yeah, I was going to say, very interesting. We're trying to take our students that graduate from school and put their certificates of graduation up on the blockchain right now.
Yeah.
Because there's takes a long time for a student to get, you know, the college or university to confirm that they did graduate there for a new job or something.
Right.
And if they had it just on their phone and it was on the blockchain, it would be so easy just to do it in like 1 minute. It's immutable, you know, and irrefutable. So this is our next big interest, aside from VR and HoloLens attendance for classes. We're already doing that, but yeah, we're struggling trying to get to figure out how to put these. It's only been experimental so far, putting a couple of them up. But well, guys, when we come back, we're going to take a look at ArcGens's website. And Marques, are you going to lead us around in that groovy three-dimensional museum today?
It would be my pleasure.
Okay, we could walk around inside the three-dimensional museum and see some artwork. Aside from the website, when you go in, Marques also has, like, I went in one day. He told me, go in here, and he sent me a link. And there was a digital, like, Android guy that greeted me. It was really...
Yeah, he's our assistant. He's our assistant.
Yeah.
Yeah.
He was really cool to meet and walk around the gallery and see the artwork. So, all right, guys, we'll be right back, and we're going to take a look at ArcGens when we come back.
Hey, Chef Al here. Want to tell you about my Amazon best-selling memoir cookbook, A Chef Is Born, chock full of recipes, also ranked the 77th book of all time out of 99, according to the Book Authority.
It's a good book by chef than you.
Yeah.
Did you ever miss someone who has passed away? Now there's Mishiram app, giving people a brand new way to tribute the lives of deceased loved ones or simply remember tender memories. This exclusive app is a user-friendly social media platform, giving people everywhere a respectable and comfortable place to create private or public memoriams. Mishugram has additional features like chat rooms and links to deceased databases and inspirational quotes. Users can also comment and connect on public posts. Join us and keep memories alive forever. Everyone wants to be remembered. For more details and download on the Google Play or Apple App Store, visit miss-u-gram.com.
Did you know that at least half of the world's population still does not have access to essential health services? One of the biggest problems in developing countries is the lack of medical monitoring devices. We have a solution. Kipuwex. Kipuwex is an easily attachable, lightweight, IOMT device which continuously measures all the clinically relevant biomarkers vital to the assessment of your health. Kipuwex uses smart algorithms to provide efficiently reliable measurements for healthcare professionals. The biomarkers can be monitored remotely anywhere and at any time with a mobile and web application. Kipuwex is not limited by physical infrastructure and is suitable for professional use and in the future for home users as well. A simple user interface will let you choose which biomarkers you want to view and displays them on easy-to-read graphs. We here at Kipuwex want to combat healthcare inequality and help millions of people around the world.
Well, guys, we are back again, and I'm here with my co-host.
Seven p.m. So it's quite dark, and people are starting to, you know, celebrate Eid in their own homes because they're all under lockdown. Yeah, that's the general environment currently.
Yeah, and it's just sun coming up here in the United States. On the eastern seaboard, I think it may still be dark on the west coast. So, and even darker, it's the middle of the night in Hawaii. So, but it's supposed to be rather cool today, not as hot. I walked a mile and a half on Saturday with the big reunion group that was here. And I want to bring back some of our guests, particularly Naquib today, because Naquib, what is going on in your part of the world, in Bangladesh?
No.
This is from
India.
Yeah. So.
Oh, I'm sorry. I'm confusing Naquib with Istiak. Naquib, are you in London?
No, I'm in India at the moment as we speak.
Oh, you're in India. Which town are you in?
It's Bhubaneswar. It's on the eastern side of India. It's a nice green. It's a bay region. So we have like sea around and forests, very green, very nice climate. So.
And what is going on in your part of the world?
All right, so I'm based in Melbourne. I mean, these are since the COVID days. I'm back home with my family. So I've been working on this project called Marhaba since quite some time. It is aiming at an inclusiveness in the DeFi ecosystem, right? I mean, when we did some research in the DeFi ecosystem, we found that it's great. It addresses a lot of problems. It tries to bring the unbanked population to the financial community. It tries to join them back, but it is not inclusive. By inclusiveness, I mean that it does not actually adhere to the faith-based principles of certain communities in the world, especially the Islamic community, which is almost like 24% of the global population. So although we are trying to solve a lot of problems on the technological side, we are not creating a solution to bring these kind of people, I mean, this community on board. So this is where Marhaba was formed, to bring inclusiveness in the DeFi ecosystem, apart from solving the technological challenges that the financial systems have. So like, we have a couple of products on the financial side, and because like this show is dedicated towards NFTs, so I will speak about the NFT segment in particular. So the NFT product that we are working on is called a Souq NFT. Souq in Arabic means marketplace. So it's an NFT marketplace where we promote artists across the world to come to collaborate and to create content. So the content that we are aiming is just not art that we look into. It's also institutional level NFTs that we are targeting. For example, you mentioned about your students who would be granted certificates on the as NFT. So this is what we are looking into. We are working on patents and certificates that would be issued as NFTs. We are working with a few institutions that are planning to issue their, the government institutions that are planning to issue the birth and death certificates as NFTs as well. So there are a lot of innovations that's going on as part of the research team is concerned, and pretty much this is what we are doing.
Well, sounds awesome. Thank you so much for keeping us up to date with what you're doing. This is always more of a talk show, guys, so people jump in and talk over each other. We really don't have prepared.
It was, like, great to see what Jeremy and Marcus are doing. I mean, probably I'll request an offline connection to understand more about what they are doing, and probably you can look into more about collaborations, working together, rather than working in different areas in silos. But I mean, this ecosystem can only grow and mature when people collaborate rather than working in silos on the same things, reinventing the wheels all over again.
Absolutely. And we're going to jump now into Marques is going to show us what he's got as far as going into a three-dimensional museum. And we're going to take a look at Art Gents. Also, after the next commercial break, when we come back, we have some news from Istiak in Bangladesh. So we're going to be getting to that as well. And these guys, I did want to mention, they are addicts. both Marques and Jeremy. They mentioned that they're art addicts, so that's kind of cool to see. And just so you guys know, I collect a lot of Don Troiani. He's a famous American war artist, and we have one of Don's paintings up here. But yeah, I have so much Don Troiani. It's crazy. Marques, where should we go today? Should we go to your website?
Yeah, maybe start sharing my page. I'm going to share my page with you. So first of all, I want to introduce the show. It's All Around Us, a revolutionary virtual NFT art museum curated by Mr. Jeremy Schultz, which I'm very excited about. I've been, you know, super stoked to work with Jeremy, man. He's such a dynamic person, and I'm glad that we're working together. I've told you that a million times, so.
I agree.
So this gallery is based on technology that was designed by my company that I share with three very talented people, Philip, Pierre, and Antoine, R. Jones 3D. And Jeremy and I, Jeremy came to me with this idea, NFTs, and I said, well, you know, give me a chance to think about it. Let me see how we can make this work. And then I came up with the idea of just actually displaying the NFTs as an online museum, because the goal was to show museums in particular what is the best method of sharing NFTs to their audience, because this market is only going to grow and museums are always curating artwork. So what can they do to truly display the NFTs? So Jeremy curated this show, congratulations, and worked directly with the team to put this show together. So I'm sharing my screen. Can you see my screen?
Oh, no, I don't think that we can see it. I think what I'm doing is I'm sharing. Are you sharing your screen? Okay,
yeah. I'm sharing my screen.
Let's try to add that. Okay, let's add that in then. And I'll tell you what we'll do. We'll stop sharing on my end. And what we'll do is we'll make that one large, actually. Why don't we do that?
Perfect.
Okay, there you go.
That's perfect. Yep. So you have two ways to navigate this gallery. One is just with the mouse. You can point to the floor, and it'll take you where you need to go. The other way to navigate this gallery is to play it like a video game. So for all you gamers out there, you can navigate through this gallery just like you would navigate, say, the game, Halo, and I don't know what are the other popular games that are out there right now. But, you know, you can navigate this like a video game. So I'm going to enter, because I have more flexibility with the mouse and using my keypad here. And if you can also turn up the music, Jeremy is going to he's going to take me around the gallery. I'll navigate it, and he'll talk about it, the different artists and the art pieces, and, you know, some of our philosophies behind creating this piece.
Perfect. Yeah, and I think I saw my buddy when I went in there. He was standing over to the left, and he greets you.
Here he comes.
I saw another guy today. He was a security guard. He was like a robot security guard. That's it, crypto artwork. And this is also, Marques, where you can kind of walk around and look at what you want to look at.
Yes. So you have, exactly. You have to know also that our team created that gallery only for that exhibition. So purely what you see was built from scratch by our team.
That's amazing.
And also by the music that you cannot, unfortunately, here, but the music have been made for the exhibition, and it followed the rhythm of how you should visit the exhibition. And that music have been created by a friend of mine called Zach. And he really wanted to immerse the viewer. So the experience is very, very pleasant.
Yeah, and the thing I liked about this also is you can bring up information all about the artist, visit their website, make a purchase. It's a lot more than if you were to go to like a regular gallery. All they have is just a tiny little placard with a little bit of information.
Exactly. So as you can see, it's a very different style of artwork. You have artists specialized on very satisfying videos. You have artists much more on images than.
Yeah, this one was amazing, slipping through my fingers. I had to stare at that for a while.
Yeah. This artist, Andreas, I'm not going to say his last name because I'm going to kill his last name. So Andreas is specialized on those kind of satisfying videos. And they are really, really immersive. Like you want to spend hours to watch it, and the music is beautiful also. It's very, very nice artwork.
Yeah, this is Andreas Vanastet from Sweden.
Exactly.
Vanastet.
Exactly.
Vanastet.
And so as you can see, we jump from a satisfying artwork to a very much technological kind of artist. This kind of art that he's making is much more centralized on the exo robots and the texture and the much more faces, human androids, etc. So it's much more mechanical, for sure.
Yeah, and the other thing I wanted to say was with this type of gallery, could we take a second to explain what an NFT art piece is? Because there's a lot of people watching and that will watch this later that don't actually understand about GIFs or why these things are so mesmerizing.
Totally. So the thing is basically NFT artwork is a digital artwork protected by an NFT. As I say earlier, an NFT is a technology close to a cryptocurrency, so it's generated by the blockchain. Most of the time is Ethereum. But that NFT cannot be, so that token cannot be used as a way to exchange because the value is not based on the general blockchain. Blockchain, as can be Bitcoin. If you buy one Bitcoin and someone else buy one Bitcoin, this Bitcoin worth the same. When you buy an NFT and someone else buy another NFT, it doesn't worth the same because it's a unique creation. So now artists use that unique token. So as a way to authenticate and to trace their artwork. So if I can give you a visual way to see an NFT is kind of transparent safer than it's unique. So with a unique reference, and when you take your artwork in that transparent safer, it fused together. So it becomes one unit. At that moment, the NFT artwork cannot be dissociated. So when you exchange the artwork, you exchange the full package. So you exchange that transparent safer with the artwork. And which is really good with NFT also, that is interesting for artists, is allow them when someone sell again their artwork to receive direct royalties. That it's not always the case with physical artwork. So it really give another way to see art, but also for artists to receive what they deserve, for sure.
Yeah, to receive what they deserve. Yeah, if it's on the blockchain, it's kind of hard to hide.
I know, absolutely. It's impossible because it's encrypted, and it cannot be delayed. So it's in the blockchain forever.
Ah, Thanos glove.
Yeah, with the principle, the five principal cryptocurrencies.
Oh man, that is hilarious. So yeah, yeah. I just would like to say this is why a lot of these NFTs are so exotic, and what the hubbub is all about. Exactly. With these NFTs, and some people say it's dumb, it's stupid. Why would you pay for something that to look at on your cell phone? You know, it's actually not, once you understand the complexity of some of these, you know, where we were watching the...
Totally. So, for example, if I can give you an example, that artist, Michael Cena, the artwork that you see, it's unreal. It's 50 meters. 50 meters. So you see, it's huge. It's like you own a huge artwork. So as you can say properly, Marty, is people think that because it's vulgarly said as a PDF, but it's not a PDF. It's the future of artwork, because that artwork you can keep it for your future descendant, or you can give it as a legacy, and it's much more easier to transfer it than a physical artwork, and logistically also, and he have the same value, because let's be honest, the current society is evolving with technology, so artists has to follow that. So it's just another way to see art. And obviously, visual art is easier to understand, if I can say, but digital artwork works the same. It's just not the same medias and the same support.
Yeah, any questions, guys? Anybody?
Yeah, I have a question. It's just like you said, the size is actually bigger in real life. How much energy is being used during the minting process from, you know, changing the actual artwork to the digital artwork? And I also have a comment to make. I think there's a lot of artists out there that can actually, they're very interested to join the NFT market, but they really need help to actually convert this the real artwork into a digital one. So perhaps you can elaborate on that as well.
Yeah. So the easiest way that I would say to digitalize a physical artwork is to take the best possible picture, a full HD picture that can be as a image easily digitalized, because it's already dematerialized. But for a sculpture or something on 3D, such as a sculpture or installation, it's much more complicated, because except taking a picture, a video, sorry, of that creation and uploaded with NFT, you have two different technology that can be used. You have the photogrammetry, which is basically big quantity of pictures that you take on certain angle of your creation. So after that, an algorithm will compress all of them and create a 3D creation. So it's based on your video or on your image, because a video is continuing following up of images. Or you have the other technology called LiNAR, which is a laser. So the laser will scan the creation with the light and create a 3D element that you can have on the last iPhone. But those technology required pretty big experiences on that. I'm not gonna lie to you. And it can be quite complicated for any artist to use those technology. So the easiest way is to take a video or a picture of the artwork and update on any NFT platform to link them with an NFT.
Thank you.
I think the energy yeah, associated with the not necessarily NFTs, but the crypto mining. That's where the bulk of the energy is being exerted is in the crypto mining. So, I mean, compared to that, you know, the NFTs themselves are using, you know, definitely not using as much energy. Hopefully that answers your question, too.
Yeah, I was going to say, I love the ones that are moving. But my question today was for you guys in the gallery, as gallery owners, are people displaying this art in their estates and in their homes on a huge screen where maybe two or three different pieces can be displayed? Is that something they're doing?
Sure.
There's different ways to display it. I'll give a shout out to Sedition because I love their platform and what they did with visual arts and videos and all that stuff, because it allows you to display it on your cell phone, which is something that we wanted to achieve in our gallery. Like, so let's just say from a design aesthetic, I hate TVs. I really, really hate TVs. I think they're the ugliest thing that you can have in your room. But what if you can turn your TV into an art piece? So when you're having a dinner party, or if you're having guests over for, you know, drinks or something like that, you can have like the change of digital artwork on you loaded onto your television screen. On your television. So that's one way of displaying it. You can also display it on a computer. I can display it there on my computer. So, you know, digital art allows us to turn digital hardware like TVs into art pieces. His name is Terry.
Oh, I think he's frozen.
Okay. Yeah, we might have been losing him there for a second, but go ahead, Farah.
I'm gonna follow what you say, and also you in the very close future, we'll be able to wear technology glasses. So the technology of AR allowed us to see much more than just the reality that we are seeing. So having a digital artwork will also allow the future owner to use those glasses and those technology to project it on the wall or to show it to his friend, more than just the TV. It's you have to see the future, the technology evolving. The holographic technology is in the beginning. The AR technology is growing, such as the VR technology. So it's just a way to project another type of artwork. So it's a very interesting present but future way to see art.
It's amazing to see, and yeah, I'm, of course, could think like, have it up on a screen or something with a beautiful frame around it. Even putting like a modern 110-inch, you know, huge plasma or QLED, but having the old world 1700 gold frame around it. And that comes to mind easily. But I think the ones for me that are the most interesting is the Aka. How do you feel? I like the ones that are actually moving. They're mesmerizing.
Yeah, I agree.
Those are really cool. And Marques, those are gifts. Aren't those gifts?
The ones that are moving are gifts.
Oh. So everybody knows what a gif is.
Wow. It's really beautiful.
They're really beautiful. The artist did an amazing job. Hey, Jeremy, do y'all want to talk about the artist a little bit? Jeremy, he and Leo started to curate this show. I think it took, what, about a month and a half? Something like that?
Yes. Yes, exactly.
Yeah, it took about a month and a half.
Yeah. So the artists that we chose are from everywhere in the world except France. That was also a want to escape the easy way to select artists. But yeah, the artists are really in different kind of artwork, and that was also the want of that exhibition. Two of them, so Vratislav Peka, aka Poster Lab, and Jan Kalab,
both
are from Czech Republic, and they are originally physical artists. Physical artists. They are painter, and they wanted to try to do digital artwork and to involve themselves in NFT. So they created a collection of artwork that have been sold pretty quickly, thanks by their notoriety, but also by the curiosity of having a physical and also a digital version of their artwork. So that was also the one to bring digital artists and also physical artists to see how the both vision can collaborate together and create another dimension of artwork, basically.
That's so nice. You guys have here, like, if you're looking at this artist and then it says more from this artist.
Yeah.
It has other pieces that they've done, and yeah.
So those artists that you can see are artists that Argence are promoting. We are also specialized on artwork offers to collectors. So we are basically looking for artists for collectors and artwork for professionals and everyone, basically. We wanted with that new exhibition to also offer that digital part for everyone and to allow the audiences to see that there is also digital part of art.
And is right. This where we had gone in before? This is where I went in, actually, via OpenEye. I think I was walking around in here, Marques, that day.
Yeah. So, I mean, OpenEye is a foundation for photographers. And this is another gallery that was designed by Arjones 3D. And, you know, during COVID, many art fairs tried to have online art fairs that failed miserably. People complained about it. They weren't done very well. The artwork wasn't shown very well. So if you go into this art fair gallery, it's set up just like the NFT exhibition. And you can move around the gallery with the two different navigations. You can also click on each one of the artworks that you're interested in and learn more about the artist by clicking on the artist's name. And, you know, we wanted to, in general, create spaces that are interactive, that are fun, that are very pleasing to the eye. And then also, it will help collectors find and purchase art. So that was the whole goal of creating this art fair. And so I think we really accomplished that goal. I really believe we accomplished that goal. And I think in the future, you'll see more shows like this. Also, what's interesting about this gallery is that various art fairs are going to want to brand their gallery to meet their vision. And so it was important for them to know that they are able to change the walls. They're able to change the size of the booths. They can change the shapes of the booths. You know, they can change the ceiling. This platform is completely customizable for art fairs to use, and I can confidently say that it is the best solution on the market for art fairs. And then, you know, I can say the same thing about the NFTs as well on the NFT gallery.
Well, look how big this warehouse is. This warehouse is massive. Yeah. And we just went to see Michelangelo in Charlotte, is here, the Sistine Chapel. And then also the same day in the morning, before that, we went to see the massive Van Gogh exhibit, which was very immersive. With the walls and everything changing and the music, and the size of this facility would cost somebody so much money, and to set all these booths up and you know, the proper temperature control and hydrometers and everything that we do in museums. I'm sitting inside the museum here right now at the United States Presidential Culinary Museum, but this stuff is not cheap to do, and the insurance policies and everything, and liability, because the person was walking and they fell and hurt their knee, and so they feel like they need 4.2 million euro or they're going to sue. You have to have the policies just to even allow people to come in, the bathroom facilities, all types of stuff. And then, you know, they say,
I mean, that's a necessary evil. Unfortunately, like, I would never say that this virtual art fair will replace actually seeing the art in person. I would never say that. This complements those art fairs. This tool allows them to extend that art fair beyond 4 days that the art fair takes place. Instead of 4 days, it can go 2 weeks or 3 weeks, and then they can save money by having the physical show 4 days, but then the collectors can revisit that artwork if they didn't buy it at that time and it's still available. They can revisit that artwork in this virtual space that will basically replace, could replace their website or be a complementary to their website. So, you know, virtual galleries are not designed to replace galleries. They're designed to enhance them. They're designed to enhance them. And as an art collector, I do want to see the artwork in the physical form. And I think that's why my clients really trust me on the personal shopping side of it, is because they trust my eye. They trust that I know what a quality piece of artwork looks like. So, you know, I would never think of this as a replacement. Just think of it as a enhancement or a complement to the physical shows.
Just amazing. We're going to take another break, guys. And when we come back, we're going to wrap up today's show, but not before hearing from Istiak and what he's got going on. Any parting comments from Farah?
Oh, yeah. I would like to say that due to this very auspicious day of Eid, we're so happy to hear about this NFT museum by Jeremy and by Marques. It's really beautiful, wonderful. And maybe there's an NFT going there for Eid, right?
And I bet there is.
Yeah.
I hope so.
Yeah, and also I would love to also mention about a Marhaba token being one of the first Islamic DeFi token, and it's actually going to be launched soon, right, Nakib? So they have really a good business model behind them, which includes staking, yield farming, and the marketplace, and they also have the Dicha Souk, right? So it's really a wonderful thing to be having this Marhaba token and Marhaba DeFi. And Nakib, would you like to just mention a little bit on it?
Yeah, so thank you for that good thing. Yes, I mean, this is something that we are building for a general societal impact. I mean, we are almost in the final stages. You would be seeing the product going live in a few days. And let's see how it goes, because good people like Farah are always there to support and to back us.
I just want to say Marhaba means hello, so
welcome.
Marhaba.
So thank you so much, Shokran. We'll be right back, guys.
Well, this episode is when screaming guests are lit on fire inside the White House. So I know that everyone's thinking, like, what did he just say? It's one thing to... Oh my gosh, and who knew in Abilene High School that we would be able to get a photograph from Julie Eisenhower. She sent this to us.
Join former White House chef Marty Mongello as he brings to life colorful stories about America's presidents and first families that have occupied 1600 Pennsylvania Avenue Northwest. It's time to be informed and entertained with Inside the President's Cabinet. Visit the website today at www.insidethepresidentscabinet.com.
I'm Marty Mongello from the United States Presidential Culinary Museum, and welcome to another episode of Inside the President's Cabinet.
Well, thank you, everybody. I am back with Farah, and happy Eid to everyone on Earth, all across the 190 countries. The Hajj has ended. Eid has begun. Those of you who finished your prayers and tried to fast as best as you could, please just do your very best. Welcome back to Crypto Genius, our show today featuring NFT museums and several of our guests of Marques. Marques Hardin, live from Paris, and Jeremy Schultz from Paris, also studying today. Farah, what did you think so far about these NFTs?
I think it's really awesome way to also, be including the artist community, and it's actually a way for digitization. It allows for wealth distribution, a lot of people can be included finally in the economies. It's a inclusive finance.
Yeah, absolutely.
And very diverse. Yeah, it covers anyone can actually now. It's just for them to be hardworking and to actually find out how to actually propel themselves further in life.
I also wanted to bring on another one of our friends that had popped in. Istiak Doza, what is going on in your part of the world?
So honestly, I just got involved with learning about cryptocurrencies just a couple of months ago. And I actually want to start by thanking Marty because it was one of his speeches during a GBA event. That's a Government Blockchain Association event, I think, regarding gold ATM or something along those lines.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yes,
and
first of all.
Inspiring.
And I remember, you actually, Marty, all right, explained blockchain in such a way that I thought, my God, I have to learn more about this. Long story short, I am now a member of the Government Blockchain Association. We are working on some blockchain-related, bringing some blockchain-related solutions to Bangladesh. And as for NFTs, while I had some idea about NFTs, today, after this, my mind is like, boom, blown. All right, that's
my mind was blown when I met Marques.
Absolutely, Marques, Jeremy, you guys are doing some incredible work, man. I can't remember who, but one of you mentioned the fact that digital artists, actually artists in general, don't always get the respect they deserve. And I feel like this is, it's incredible to know that you can create something, you can sell it, but not entirely. Like, you know, there's always this, you will always keep on getting money from it for as long as it keeps changing hands in terms of royalty. Not to mention the fact, one thing Marty mentioned was that, you know, there may not be any need for galleries. I think Jeremy said that, not Jeremy, I think Marques said that it was it's probably not going to be a replacement, more like a compliment. But at the same time, when that conversation was happening, my mind was going, wait, what else can we put, put in as an NFT? Can I put my house as an NFT? Can I, like gold, all right, okay, it's somewhere on the planet. Can we just put, okay, like this country has this much gold, let's put it out in NFTs, and then, people all over the world can own it or portions of it according to their, level of income and whatnot. It's exciting. It's just, we need to have a separate conversation, probably a private conversation, but doing a brainstorming session on what else is possible. Because I think the conversation is just starting. It's exciting, guys. It's just amazing. Thank you very much.
Absolutely. It is mind-blowing. And I want to mention that Marques, I'm very proud of him because he was an enlisted man in the United States Air Force. And then he applied for the officers program and went to the academy for training and became an officer in the United States Air Force. Nice. And so myself, Navy, 30 years. My wife did 6 years in the Navy. My father was Army. My uncle was Army. So we're very proud of Marques. And he's living in Paris. I mean, who isn't jealous?
Absolutely. Hey, thanks, Mike.
So, yeah. Any right, final?
Keep that on the low. Don't tell everybody.
Well, I just told the world. And who knows how many people are going to be watching this? Any final things, guys? The website is artgents.co. If you're looking for it, make sure .co. There's some other ArtGents things out there. It can be a little bit confusing, but ArtGents.co, www.artgents.co. These guys also, in addition to being addicts and needing therapeutic care because they love art so much, they also do personal art shopping, and we never got a chance to mention that. So, Marques and Jeremy, would you mind for our two percenters and family offices that watch our channels, would you mind just you and Jeremy talking about your personal art shopping and how the process begins and then where you go with that?
Yeah, I mean, personal art shopping is for the busy professional, but it's also for the person who are right now just novice in the art industry. The first thing I want to mention is, art collecting is not unattainable. And you don't have to spend $1 million to consider yourself to be a art collector. This piece on the wall, it was a very good value piece that I purchased. And then I purchased like two other pieces along with street artists. So the idea of our service is to walk people through the process of finding art, purchasing art, and receiving art. And we do that by the use of, I use the tool Pinterest, because when I work with a collector, I want to get a sense of their taste. And then also the collector needs to get a sense of what they like and what they don't like. How does art piece make them feel or don't feel? And I think that's really important, because you, as a collector, you're investing in the artist, and also you're going to live with that art piece for a very, very long time. And so it's important for me as the personal shopper to connect the right artist with the collector. And so one of the things I love to do is to have the collector actually meet the artist. Now, artists are sometimes extremely shy, but also I think, collector gets a sense of why the artist created that piece, what motivated them, the environment that they're in. And, you know, I just think it's really cool, especially when you go to the dinner table or and you have friends over and you see a piece like this and you want to talk about it, right? You just want to talk about it. So, you know, the personal art shopping service is specifically for that. And then Jeremy is a specialist in street art, which is another form of art that I absolutely love. I have a Ratour and Scarrow, and also Opar in my collection.
True. Yeah, and that's a very, you know, personal art shopping it's something much more, as you say, personal. So the gallery are becoming more and more a place to just sell art and not give that much of history. And we are just connecting the artists with the collectors. So we give a link, we give an affection with them. So it brings the art in a real dimension of what is it? It's a representation of an emotion. It's a moment of that artist fixing a moment of his life on the media. So we give them that history to those collectors, and you know, we have a special relationship with them, and it's very important. It's very important.
It is. And artists, I mean, literally, like the artists think of these pieces as their babies. I mean,
yeah,
and they want to make sure that those babies enter, you know, the right adoptive family, you know, really. And so, I mean, I was just think of about it like that. And artists are very sensitive creatures. They're very sensitive creatures, and they're very, you know, sensitive about their artwork. And, you know, it's our goal. And it's our goal to pair the right artist with the right collector. The other thing too is access. A lot of people in this world, rich middle class, they don't have access to a lot of artwork that's available. Now, we live in Paris, and in Paris, I think there's about 150 to 200 galleries, like that. And then if we go into artist studios, if we count the number of artist studios and artists that are living in France in general, my God, that number explodes. And the same thing for, you know, the United States. And so for a collector, that can be really overwhelming. And we want to be able to break that down for them. We don't want them to have to look at, you know, 100, 200 websites to try to find a piece of art. It's better if we get an understanding of what they're looking for, and then we can narrow it down to, you know, a few different sites or artists or et cetera. So it really is,
Marques,
it really is
a good service. You mentioned access, but access is also strictly controlled for the artist. We had an American girl that went to live in Paris. Her name was Mary Cassatt. And her and all her friends, like Renoir and whatnot, couldn't get in. They were not going to be shown, and they considered that their ideas were idiotic and stupid and childish, their new art forms. And they could not get any gallery to pick them up because the Golden Society in Paris told them, we are not going to showcase what looks to us like wallpaper. Now, we're talking about, you know, Auguste Renoir and many of Mary's friends calling their art wallpaper, you know, and that is what it is good for, is for the wallpaper. So if that is what you like, they couldn't get shown. They could. So you know what they did? They opened up their own gallery and did their own salon. And you Perfect. Guys are making it actually more possible to by having this digital gallery. Also, like I said, that warehouse is so big. It's possible to fit more artists in. Space is a premium.
Yeah, it's true. Let me say a couple of things about that. First of all, there are a million artists. There are a lot of artists, okay? There's very few galleries compared to the number of artists that are out there creating work and selling work. So galleries, and I'll defend the galleries here. The galleries have to make strategic choices for their galleries to show, because their collectors are very specific. Gallery collectors, they are expecting certain type of artwork for each gallery that you visit. They have a specialization for a specific type of artwork, and their collectors know them as that, right? And so, you know, for the artists out there that get frustrated with galleries, just realize that you're one of a ton of artists that are submitting their work to galleries, and galleries have to really, you know, strategically choose artists that they can actually sell, because it is, I would tell you this, that is very expensive to run a gallery. It is very expensive. And yes. So with that, keeping that in mind, the galleries have to be prudent with what they select, and I just believe that artists now have other tools such as Instagram, such as Pinterest, such as people like myself and Jeremy, who and art advisors who are there specifically to help your art be found. So I want to encourage artists that you don't need a gallery to validate your work. You don't need a gallery to validate your work. Even with that being said, there's artwork that are validated or priced a certain way because of a gallery. But just for artists who wants to create and sell their work, you don't need a gallery for validation. So don't let that discourage you, really. Don't let that discourage you.
Yeah, it makes you wonder, Naqib, if they're going to have an artist, you know, a very famous artist design a coin someday. That would be kind of cool. Because right now we just have graphic artists that do coins.
Oh, actual cryptocurrency.
Yeah, just imagine, Marques, if you married like an exhibition of coins and crypto with specific artists who, you know, are releasing tonight these six, you know, brand new renditions or whatnot for coins. I know that Dogecoin, you know, it has the dog on it. That's not very nice.
The difference between an NFT and a coin is that a coin is divisible and an NFT is not divisible. So what you give a front end or a front image to it depends on your choice. For example, Jeremy and Marques, they are giving the front image as an art. But in the back end, it's nothing but a token. It's a smart contract that's being deployed on the blockchain that is not divisible. But then again, there are fungible, non-fungible tokens as well. That's again a different concept where you can, when artists collaborate together to build a specific artwork, and then when they are sold, they are sold in batches as well. For example, I see a piece of portrait and I just want to buy the hat, and somebody else just wants to buy his watch. So all of these can be done. Those things are possible with the help of fungible NFTs. But then again, coins and tokens that we see as of now, they are nothing but the principle behind all of them are the same. They are nothing but the pieces of code. They are deployed on the blockchain. That's it.
Yeah. Well, thank you, everybody, for joining us for this episode of Crypto Genius. Has everybody been served and everybody got out what they wanted to say?
I think so.
Did anybody feel like they were mansplained or walked on?
No, I don't know.
Okay. Well, guys, have a great day. And thank you so much for everything you're doing.
Thank you, Marques, Jeremy,
thank you, Marty.
Take care now.
Thank you. Have a great day.